Today, I am wearing a number of hats. I am a craft historian, a cultural historian, a textile historian, and ultimately a professor. My goal is to introduce you to a little-known Canadian photographer who worked in Victoria, BC at the end of the 19th century. And in doing so, I want to show you how my research has added to an ongoing academic conversation about craft in Canada. My specific area of interest is fashionable domestic embroidery and the role it played in the construction of female identity at the end of and during the 19th century. Informing my research is a familiarity with Victorian ideology of separate spheres, a belief system that earmarked power and privilege for men. Middle-class men were to be active within the public sphere, while women were expected to remain passive within the domestic sphere of home and family. In other words, man could become a professional artist while women were destined to be amateurs. It is a lifestyle that fostered the symbiotic relationship between needlework and women, with women, or with needlework, widely recognized as a signifier of femininity, respectability, and domesticity. During the 1880s, there was a period of economic prosperity in Canada, and the urban elite adopted art and culture as their leitmotif. This was manifested in a desire to promote good taste, and it fell to the lot of Canadian women to acquire and proselytize this taste within their homes, specifically the parlor. The parlor was the one room in the family home where family, friends, and carefully screened strangers were invited in and able to see the interior and see what was being done in the home. And it was the decorative skills that were on display, the decorative skills of the women, and that included photographs and embroideries, becoming what some cultural historians have called an accumulation of cultural capital. An attractive, tastefully appointed parlor was a sign of respectability. Taste was not personal. Instead, it was something sanctioned by society. Taste had moral values, and ignoring taste of the period was a sign of something really wrong. Detailed advice was plentiful, and the display of embroidery and photographs was considered essential. In a domestic guide of 1883, one reads, and I'm going to quote this guide, "Care should be taken in arranging that a room is not overcrowded." Now, just as an aside, I want you to think of that. It is not overcrowded, and then I want you to hear the description of what they're telling you have to do. "Thus, there should be a few good pictures or painted plaques mounted in plush hanging on the wall. A sash made of small pieces of bright colored plush or silk in crazy work may be flung across the table, the ends drooping low. The mantelpiece may be covered with a corresponding sash over which place a small clock as a centerpiece and arrange ornaments on each side, statuettes, bannerets, flower holders, small Japanese fans, pieces of odd china, painted candles, small sconces may all find a place on the mantel." The crazy work mentioned here appeared on the scene in the 1880s, and crazy quilts were considered original and modern and were made of tiny, irregular shaped scraps of silk that were then fastidiously embroidered. The origin of the term crazy was not derogatory. Rather, it was rooted in the West's enthusiasm for a newly discovered art, the Japanese art, and in particular, the crazed surface, that little crackler surface on ceramic pots. Indeed, the earliest references to this form of patchwork uses the descriptives Japanese and crazy interchangeably. So in the course of my research, I have studied a great number of embroideries and many crazy quilts, and I have read innumerable descriptions of embroidery and how embroidery was made to be used. However, I am continually on the lookout for documentary evidence. I want to find images of women with embroidery or images of interiors with embroidery in them. Thus, when I came across this image of an 1880s photograph of a Canadian woman with an embroidered pillow, I was delighted. My friends were less thrilled, but I was delighted. And although at that time I had no idea that this was a self-portrait, nor any idea of where this discovery might lead. The initial step was to identify the artist and locate the source of the photograph, which proved to be simple. I used Google. And Google directed me to the Victoria BC Archives, or the British Columbia Archives in Victoria. What I found left me gobsmacked. How could I not know this artist? Whereas I had hoped to find a few images that might prove an historic context for Canadian embroidery, instead I found a large collection of glass negatives that revealed a woman who confidently appropriated the visual vocabulary of domestic textiles to become a successful professional photographer. Hannah Hatherley Maynard was born in 1834, she dies in 1918, was only 18 when she and her husband Richard emigrated to Canada from England in 1854. They settled in Bowmanville, a community on Lake Ontario near Toronto, and Richard established himself as a bootmaker, okay, before he left for the gold fields of BC. How Hannah managed to survive with a young family of three and one on the way is uncertain, but when her husband triumphantly returned to move the family west, he found his wife studying photography. In 1862, with his bootmaking equipment, her photographic supplies, and their four children, Hannah and Richard set off for the colony of Vancouver Island. Hannah would describe her new home as made up of tents, gullies, and swamps, and inhabitants mostly miners. She and the children were settled in a house on Johnson Street, and Richard again headed for the gold fields. When he returned the following year, Hannah was installed as a professional photographer of portraits, working from Mrs. R. Maynard's photographic gallery. Richard established his boot and shoe business and began to learn photography from his wife. He would become a successful photographer in his own right, documenting mountain and island landscapes. Surprisingly, Hannah Maynard remains relatively unknown even today. Her work came under scrutiny in the late 70s and some in the 80s for what one author described as freakish, goofy, and often grotesque, and the designation eccentric continues to be used in describing both the artist and her photographs. However, eccentric suggests that she deviated from conventional practices and patterns. And as a textile historian, I disagree. There is a pattern here. And with their repeated images and lavish embellishments, these photographs are compositionally linked to contemporary embroidery, specifically crazy quilts. The majority of negatives held by the BC Archives reveal that Mrs. Maynard worked concurrently in a variety of genres, creating studio portraits of families, of children, group portraits, documented events, and landscapes. In 1878, she was identified by the Seattle Weekly Pacific Tribune as, and I quote, the leading photographer of Victoria, with a commodious gallery in front of which may be seen hundreds of specimens of her skill and handiwork. The author concluded that this is what, and I quote, a woman can do when there is necessity or ambition or the incentive, end of quote. A year later, the St. Louis practical photographer enthused that Mrs. Maynard is one of the most industrious and persevering ladies we have in our business. Now, the quotes themselves are wonderful. The fact that these are being written by Americans means that she was sending her work out to be critiqued in the public arena. Public, not private. Hannah was indeed industrious. She entered and won photographic competitions, she experimented with new techniques, and she aggressively marketed herself and her work. Given her drive, it is not surprising that she was a successful photographer of children, and of ladies, and of landscapes. But to discover that she was the official photographer to the Victoria Police Department, and that was in 1897, capturing not only the officers, but also mugshots of the prisoners, was a revelation. Upon her retirement in 1912, at the age of 78, she boasted of having photographed just about everyone who passed through Victoria. And this lovely picture of the woman behind me with the hat on is in fact a picture that accompanied the headlines, Mr. Kincaid murdered by his mistress. This is his mistress. This is the mugshot. And if you are a film buff, you would remember Adam's Rib, and you would remember Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy as lawyers, and you would realize that the hat that Katharine Hepburn gave the accused mitigated the trial results, and that's sort of similar to this one. However, there is a second group of photographs that are not merely unconventional, but most remarkable, and these are the ones that redirected my research. Many of the photographs are of herself and her immediate family, and even her late family, some within the studio setting and some within the family parlor. I was drawn to Maynard's photographs because of her sly, self-deprecating humor. I continue to be intrigued, not only because she incorporated fashionable textiles into her self-portraits, but also in her most widely distributed works, those labeled eccentric, she appropriated the language of textiles. By doing so, she was able to put herself forward as a professional photographer while still maintaining her status as a respectable middle-class lady, a slippery slope in this outpost of the British Empire. However, Mrs. Maynard made very few false steps. Hers was a carefully orchestrated performance, as she said, about creating objects for an emerging market of female consumers desiring to create tasteful interiors. The works that inspire me are modern in that they are autobiographical and self-reflexive. Typically, the viewer is encouraged to recognize Hannah's hand in the manipulation of the form and the content. I like to think of these as selves portraits. She was innovative, masking the lens to create double images, creating what one writer described in 1894 as photographs on the freak order, showing Mrs. Maynard in different positions on the same plate. But note two things here. The first is that freak meant whimsical or curious, and the second that they were sent out for critical engagement. In this series of photographs from the mid-1890s, we find her most fascinating narratives. Here, Hannah, with tongue-in-cheek, critiques a familiar domestic ritual, the at-home. The painted backdrop, the tea set, the tablecloth, the embroidered footstool, all speak of a fashionable domestic interior. On the left-hand side, seated, Hannah has a teapot in her hand. She is pouring tea. On the right-hand side, Hannah has a cup and saucer. She's receiving that tea. And from the framed picture behind them on the wall, another Hannah leans out, pours cream. She's causing havoc. In another, the focus has moved from tea to textiles. Here, a taunt thread, perhaps of life, draws our eye across the image as Hannah, on our right, rolls a ball of yarn, drawn from the skein that Hannah holds on the left. There are, in fact, four Hannahs in this one. Fashionable domestic textiles, the lace panels, the tablecloth, bobbin lace, an unfinished runner, a cutwork tea cloth, surround each of the Hannahs. The unfinished square of fabric in the foreground features a cyanotype and a portrait of her youngest daughter, Lily, who had recently died. This photograph resonates with the values of objects of association, whether it is the references to the deceased, Lily, or needlework as a signifier of respectability and maternalism. These are multi-layered narratives. Maynard's awareness and debt to textiles and textile techniques, in particular crazy quilts, is manifested in this slide. This is a slide that shows an images of photographs of the BC interior landscapes that have been cut apart, separated, and glued together to form a montage, a crazy quilt of photographs. She used the same technique in a series of advertising images, which she called her Gems of BC. She combined diverse photographic images of children and babies to produce new works, reconstructing, repositioning, and re-photographing the various elements. Simple geometric grids gave way to pictorial silhouettes, including horseshoes, wreaths, a crown, a turtle, an artist's palette, and even a fountain. These tiny images also appeared on dishes and leaves of plants. By framing the 1891 collection with a border of her earlier gems, Maynard incorporated approximately 22,000 faces. The editors of the St. Louis and Canadian Photographer published the 1885 version, writing, "This is the fifth year of the gathering, and they increase in number and variety year by year. Mrs. Maynard is deserving of much praise for her skill and patience," womanly attributes, "in the arrangement of these precious gems." There followed an 11-verse laudatory poem, which I will not read to you, but I will read you the last concluding lines, and I quote, "With all its charms, both grave and gay, we now will send it on its way, adown the sunny path of fame, to bless the artist Maynard's name." Like the photographs themselves, interpretations of Hannah's contributions are multiple. But without an understanding of contemporary attitudes regarding fashionable domestic embroidery, a significant and well-considered aspect of her art is missed. These photographs function as an encoded interface between the public and the private. Maynard conscientiously marketed and represented a lifestyle that was respectable. Her clothing was suitable. Her studio accoutrements, from the painted backdrops to the upholstered chairs to the aspidistra, accurate reflections of middle-class aspirations and propriety. She was always Mrs. Richard Maynard, photographic artist or artiste. Even her studio, with its separate street entrance, was physically part of the family home, the parlor and respectability only a portiere away. From a perspective of craft history, Maynard is intriguing, adding a rare voice to an ongoing narrative regarding craft in Canada. While at times slyly mocking the rituals of middle-class domesticity, she understood the power of public opinion and self-promotion and used this visual language of domestic embroidery to reinforce her own position as a professional photographer. By considering her contributions through the lens of the camera and through the eye of the needle, I believe that this research and Mrs. Maynard's photographs carry the conversation forward. Are there questions?
With reference to the image of the parlor tea pouring, mm-hmm. that's quite artistic, isn't it? Really?
Oh, yes.
Can you talk a bit about that? And was it seen as art? I mean, this is before surrealism?
This is before surrealism. So we are looking at photographs. There were photographers in France that were actually doing double negatives. We've got advertisements and we've got articles in Scientific American on how to do them. So they were out there, and we do find a few artists in France, photographers. There was always a question about whether photography is art, all right? So we find photographers in France doing similar work that will be categorized later as surreal, and they will be called sort of surrealist photographers. Hannah was not part of this group. She was never seen. She wasn't exposing her work in Europe. She was busy looking at Canada and the States. So yes, they are very, very much fine art, as far as I'm concerned. They are an incredible example of a professional artist that was successful in this sort of outpost of empire. Any other?
Go further. A lot of her work seems quite witty. Is that
yeah.
across to you?
That's why I love it. She makes me laugh. And how can you possibly not like someone that makes you laugh? So her work is witty. There's a number of her works that are quite serious. We've got pictures of the ships, and then we'd have all the captains in front of it, and the cook. She would include the cook. The cook was female. She would do the picnics. One of the pictures I showed you, I'm not sure if I showed it to you or not, but there was a picture of the Spiritualist Club in Victoria. There's no evidence that she was part of it, because this was a period when spiritual photography would also have been done. At that point where they would have had, you know, mother standing beside the son, and mother has been dead for 20 years. And photography, for some reason, we've always thought photography doesn't lie. We've got this notion that photographs don't lie, and we know in the 21st century that of course it lies. We know that things, that they manipulate things. But for some reason, we've always sort of assumed it doesn't lie. And yet if you look at the very first photographs, for instance, in France, Hippolyte Bernard did a photograph of himself as dead. It was a self-portrait as a drowned man. And what he was complaining about was the fact that Daguerre was given money by the government, and he was not. And so here he is talking about, here I am dead, you better walk around me, the body is stinking, it's starting to rot. He was lying. All right, it's not the truth. we look at the war pictures in America, and we realize that the Civil War photographers set the stage. They put the guns at the right angle. Those guns wouldn't have been left. They've got everything set up. Photography has always lied. One of the things I like about Hannah is the fact that I've discovered that she got rid of her double chins, and she nipped in her waist as well. So she was doing a little bit of photo shopping at a very early age, our period.
You mentioned that she includes the chef in the ship's photo. Mm-hmm. How conscious was she of intentionally pushing the boundaries of females?
We have nothing to prove that she was doing that, but I think her position shows that. The fact that she was putting these women in, and the fact that that nice little lady was wearing this incredible hat, Our Little Murderess. And honestly, when I think back to the movie, it was sort of this idea of dressing up the murderess. The other people that she's taken pictures of are not nearly as elegant, and they're not presented in that light. I think she found someone, and I would like to know what the outcome of the trial was. I haven't found that out.
Presumably she'd been keenly aware of the conventions and norms.
She would have. She would have studied. Well, one of the interesting things about photography in the 19th century is the fact that it wasn't gender related. It was a brand new medium, and it didn't have the rules, it didn't have the associations. So if you were a female wanting to break into the art trade and you wanted to be an artist, until the 19th century, you were not allowed to join any of the associations. And even when you were allowed to join the associations, you were limited in what you were allowed to do or paint. Photography didn't have those rules. And in fact, when we look at the early photographers like Fox Talbot or Daguerre, we discover that their wives were exceedingly active in their practices. And in fact, their wives did most of the developing. Because after all, women cook and mix things, and it just seemed natural. So women were allowed to do photography, and they were encouraged to do photography in some ways. To become a professional was questionable, but there were some photographers that were professional artists. And what's interesting is many of them used textiles when they did self-portraits. So we've got Lady Hockaden, which is this incredible photograph of her with her lovely dress, with the embroidery, with her camera taking her picture, but the lovely embroidery is there as well.
Did she influence other artists or other practitioners?
We don't have any record of that. I don't have any record of that. The fact that we've still got this collection of glass plates is exciting. When she retired, she gave all of her equipment to a, and I quote, Chinaman named Peter, end of quote. So she was definitely aware that she was passing on a tradition to someone else that was an outsider. We have no history or records of Peter. But she did photograph First Nations. She photographed the Chinese immigrants coming in for the railway, the laundry makers. She was doing work subjects. She was doing landscape. And as I said, her husband learned photography from her. She had associates. She hired apprentices. One was with her for 30 years. They were men. And one of my favorite stories about her, there's many stories, but one of my favorite stories is the fact that her granddaughter, she taught her kids to do photography, but she also taught her grandchildren. And her granddaughter photographed, sort of forensically, the very first or one of the first car accidents in Victoria. She had her camera and she took pictures.
So to what extent did she engage in social documentary? Because you've hinted at it, interesting.
We've only got the photographs. We've got a couple of diaries, but they really tell us very little. We've got a couple of diaries when they went on trips around the Queen Charlotte Islands, which was interesting. But we really don't have any documents about how she felt, what she was doing, what she was saying. She had, I think, about 8 children. So she was a mother, she was busy, and she was this photographer as well. And 50 years in the business.
Did she write much?
Nope. Did not write much. So we've got very few documents. We have, as I said, a journal, a trip that she went up the Queen Charlotte's where she sort of complains about the weather and you know, what they're going to take a picture of and how long it takes to develop something and that it's raining and that it's the souvenirs that they're buying. And in some of her pictures, you can actually see some of the souvenirs they bought. So what I find interesting is there were some souvenirs from Quebec, Ontario, Ganawage, and then there was also Haida. So she's got this incredible collection, which would have been typical of the time.
How would she have actually been introduced to photography and got training in that?
All right. Well, she was in we're not really sure, but she was in Bowmanville, and Bowmanville had a photographer and insurance company, one and the same, R.O. O'Hara, and we think she was studying there. She thinks she was just sort of going in and learning how to do photography. In fact, there was another woman at the same time that was doing photography, and I've been trying to trace her, some of her work as well. So there were two women probably just getting lessons from someone because they were interested and had enough money to pay for the equipment. Because when she went west, she definitely had equipment with her.
How would she have been exposed to other artists, other photographers' work? Was she engaged in kind of like a...
Again, we can only look at the images and try to guess. One of the worst pictures of her, or the really bad picture I've seen of her, was one after she'd given birth to her baby. She's holding her baby. She's fully dressed, but she's holding her baby, and she looks older than any other picture I've ever seen, and that was taken by another photographer. Now, she could have been exhausted. He may have been less than enthusiastic about her. I don't know, but... And the other problem is with our pictures is the fact that we've got the negatives. So when you look at some of them, you'll realize we're seeing all of the area around the picture. So when I'm standing here, I've got a white screen behind me and I've got a screen, but you're not seeing everything else that's in the room. And suddenly, if you stand back further, you would see everything else that's just in this room and you would realize that it hasn't been edited yet. So what we're looking at are the negatives that are not edited. So in some cases, they have been a little bit of the white out for the nipped in waist and that chin, but in other cases, we're still seeing the things that are holding things up. So the fake fireplace, the stuffed dog. Actually, I didn't see a lot of stuffed dogs in her work. Notman photographs in Montreal, they have three stuffed dogs, a black dog, a black and white dog, and a small white dog, because dogs did not stand still for their photographs.
What's your favorite anecdote?
For Hannah? I'm sorry, there's just too many interesting stories about Hannah, and the photographs tell such good stories. So we have the one picture of the camera being a huge camera on the street. It's a float, an advertising float for them. We have pictures of her propped up on bicycles. Still, the bicycles are propped up so it looks like she's riding a bicycle. They're outside. We have her works that she won prizes for that appear in many of her photographs. Just the idea of the tea scene, I think, is probably one of my favorites, one of the more popular ones as well. And just that she is funny. And that she was sending these things out to be looked at. That, to me, is the really important thing. All right?
Any questions I should ask?
I don't think there's, I can't think of anything. Some of her work we have photographed. I'm always looking for images of her work on eBay. I haven't come across any yet. Because she would have had a little signature, it would have been stamped on the back. There are photograph albums that they have at the archives, so people would be looking at these photographs in their parlors. And there's a lovely story that said that they thought the little heads of the babies were in fact pictures of the babies that she took that year. And I'm thinking, 22,000? I do not think so. Not when there's a matter of a few, maybe less than 100 babies born in a year. So she was taking pictures, she was appropriating imagery. Oh, one of my favorite stories about Hannah is a quote from one of the newspapers or journals. And I found it fascinating because they suggested that any photographer would be smart to order a set of her prints and pin them up outside of their own door. And for me, the mind boggles. Because does that mean that you're saying, I know this woman, therefore I'm a good photographer? Or are you saying, these are my photographs, I'm a good photographer, I can do this? And I thought it was a rather interesting idea of the temperament and the thought processes of the era.
Are we able to look back yet and evaluate her legacy?
I think we're starting to. I think we're starting to understand the importance of women in the arts in Canada. And I think we're starting to import, I think what we're really starting to discover is that the Victorian era and the separate spheres, which is how I started my talk, and the idea that women are in the professionals, or men are in the professional sphere and women are in the private sphere, was undergoing a really strong change at the end of the century. The end of the century, they were still Victorian women. Victoria was on the throne from 1837 to 1901, so it was the Victorian era. The Edwardian era before World War I was not a great deal different. But what we start to see is at the end of the century, women are on the move. We've got the suffrage movement in the 1870s. We've got women allowed into universities in the 1860s. We're starting to see the formation of the United Women's Association. We are seeing the WCTU, which is the Women's Christian Temperance Union, are all being formed at this point. Women are taking their role in public. Public is not necessarily happy about this. The status quo is being changed, the weight shift is happening, but Hannah is one of those women. And by using humor, like feminists before her and after her, I'm not saying she is a feminist, but certainly she seems to be, she is using humor, and that's a nice way into it.